from the University of Pretoria. Please go ahead.
Okay, thank you very much. And I mean, it's this talk was supposed to be given by the co-author Mustafa Mokhtar Karoubi, but at the last moment, actually, he asked me to prepare the talk and give it. So this talk about our joint paper. Okay, so we'll be talking about fragmentation coagulation models. I talked a little bit about this on Tuesday, but let us repeat that we are looking at the differential, integral differential equation. So you have dQ equal to this expression on the right hand side. And U in this case describes the density of particles of size or mass S. A is the overall rate of fragmentation. So the situation is that we have collection of clusters of particles of size X, 1, 2, 3, in general it's arbitrary real variable. And these particles can split. And they split at the rate A. So this is the loss term here. So the rate of change of the number of particles of size X is decreased. The rate of change is given by the decay of particles. So they are removed from the class X, but also bigger particles, particles with size bigger than X can fragment into smaller particles and they can join the class X at the rate here given by this non-local integral operator. This is a linear equation, but in general, the rates are singular, unbounded. So this is on the right-hand side, we have an unbounded operator. The function B in the kernel is the so-called fragmentation kernel, and it gives the distribution of the sizes of the daughter particles of coming from size Y mother. So clearly B must be zero for X bigger than Y. And also if you sum up together masses of all daughter particles coming from the mother of size Y, the total mass must be again Y. So this is actually something which is called the local conservation of mass principle. We define moments of the solution by the standard equation here. However, there often occur events which can change the total mass of the system. So mass loss can arise due to oxidation, melting, sublimation. Mass gain can occur due to the precipitation of matter from the environment or by belt inside clusters. So in this talk, we'll focus on the growth case. And in this case, our original fragmentation equation is augmented by the term describing the growth of particles at the rate R. We are talking, you know, we will be approaching this from the point of view of functionalism semigroup of operators theory. So we must set everything in proper Banach spaces. And in this case, proper Banach spaces, physically relevant Banach spaces are the space L1 and just the space L1 and the space L1 with the weighted measure x dx. So for a non-negative solution, the zeroth order moment and the first order moment give the total number of particles in the system and the size, the mass and size of the system. By the modeling, from the modeling process or formally integrating equation, the equation, the original equation two, we find that the total mass should be conserved. Unfortunately or fortunately for us mathematicians, it is not always the case for true solutions. There could be processes in which the mass is decaying. And the same happens with models with rate or growth. In this case, actually, the mass can change not according to the formal integration. These properties of these two norms make the analysis of the problem quite difficult. And actually, we can improve our analysis by constructing, by using the spaces in which we prevent building of too many large clusters. So we will be working in higher moment spaces x alpha or x zero alpha, where instead of weight x, we simply penalize big particles. So we require the solutions to be integrable with weights of higher power. The main question which we want to address here is the question whether the semigroup solving equation 5, which hopefully does exist, whether this semigroup has the so-called asynchronous exponential growth property. So if long-term behavior of the semigroup can be really described by just one-dimensional projection, multiplied possibly by a scaling factor due to growth or decay of the solutions. So this is the main question we'll try to address, whether something, this representation is possible. It turns out that the answer to this question strongly depends on the space in which we work and also on the properties of the growth rate. So in this case, in our paper, we consider two main assumptions for the growth rate. So of course, growth rate in this case should be positive, and we assume that it's a continuous function. And then we impose two conditions. One, that the reciprocal of R is integrable close to zero, or it is not integrable close to zero. The other two conditions are the same here. Essentially, they tell us that the characteristics of the problem of the first order differential equation involved in the whole process, these characteristics are well defined. They don't blow up in finite time. It turns out that if we use 10, so if the growth rate is integrable close to zero, then we need to impose boundary conditions. And in our case, we simply say that at the boundary, nothing is coming in from outside. So we impose zero boundary condition. There is a large body of literature dealing with this problem, bounded state space. So when the size was restricted, is well understood from the work of Dieckmann, Himans, and Thieme, though in the study with Richard Rudnitsky and Katarzyna Pichur, it turns out that it's quite difficult to deal with some unbounded rates. A lot of results were obtained by French school using general relative entropy. Some results have been established by probabilistic methods by Bertouin and Marta Trion-Kamińska and Biedrzycka. Here we focus on operator theoretic results, which started with the work of Michler, Bernard, Gabriel, Canizo, Scher, and so on. This analysis is based on the study of Perron eigenvectors and eigenvalues. This essentially was probably initiated by Marie Dumic-Geoffroy. There are some other results which are pertaining to this model. If we look from the operator theoretical point of view, the main strategy is essentially to write our equation as an abstract ordinary differential equation in particular Banach space. And what we would like to prove is, first of all, the generation of the transport part or transport absorption part. We would like to get some compactness result related to the operator T, for example, compactness of the resolvent or something like that. Then we would like actually to establish the generation by the full equation, by the full operator. Then hopefully we would like to establish the compactness of the resolvent of the full generator, and then try to use some tools to extract information about the relation between so-called essential and peripheral spectra of the full semigroup V. For example, if we can prove that the full semigroup is analytic, then automatically we have compactness of V. However, for example, this approach was done by myself, Sergei Shindin, and Luke Joel for discrete cases. It is possible for discrete fragmentation, but it is impossible, of course, in the case of continuous size. So we'll try to go step by step through this plan. And first of all, essentially the transport part can be written explicitly. And the problem is simply to prove that these explicit formulas define the semigroup. And here in this table, you can see that in general, if you take the assumption that the growth rate is bounded, let us say bounded at zero, and we are working in the so-called homogeneous space, so with only weight X alpha. In this case, you don't have generation of the semigroup. So we have the formula for the solution, but this doesn't define the semigroup. Fortunately, in the other three cases combination, we have generation under certain conditions on the growth rate. So this is done. And then we try to establish compactness of the resolvent of the generator of the this transport part. And for this, we have two tools. First of all, there is an important estimate, actually, pointwise estimate of the resolvent, which can be proved, and also some sort of like regularization of the resolvent. So essentially, if you apply the resolvent to an element in X alpha or, element of X alpha or X zero alpha, then after the application by the resolvent, actually the integrability property is improved. These two properties can be used to prove compactness of the resolvent, provided we have something which my co-author calls thinness assumption of the level set of A. So essentially what we have here, what we require here is that if, for example, we have A of X of this form, and then we take the sublevel set. So if we consider C here, then what we look at is the characteristic function of this sublevel set. So in this case, we have characteristic function of the sublevel set. And then we see that this term here, cuts parts of the domain which corresponds to zero and infinity. So because in general, for example, R can be zero at zero and goes to infinity at infinity, taking this product essentially removes these parts of R which are not desirable. So for example, 15 is satisfied if A is going to plus infinity as Y goes to plus infinity. So if you have this case, and 16 occurs in the case which I presented here on the picture. Okay, so these are assumptions which are necessary for compactness of the resolvent of T. And then, in fact, we can prove these two results. This is a very nice application of the properties of L1 space. Just to mention what are the tricks used here. We have this pointwise estimate of the resolvent. So it turns out that if we cut the finite interval here, so if you multiply the resolvent by characteristic function of some finite interval, and we consider this set for all f's with norm smaller or equal than one, then first of all, because this is simply, in this case, this set is bounded by a fixed function. So it is an order interval in L1, and therefore this would be compact. Then using the second property of the resolvent, which I presented to you, we can prove that some nice estimates for the complement of this interval. And this is actually can be made arbitrarily small by playing with constant C and this epsilon. In this way, combining these two results, we proved that the full set, so if we remove this one here, so the set of all functions of the form R lambda Tf, when the norm of f is smaller than one, this set is Wittke compact for large L. And then again, we use the L1 properties. So if we write the resolvent equation, then we can see that R, the resolvent, R of T is weakly compact. And product of two weakly compact operators in L1 is compact. So here we have compact operator. Here we have an operator which goes to zero in uniform norm, in uniform operator topology as mu goes to infinity. And therefore we can prove that the resolvent of T is actually compact. So in this way we obtain that T is a resolvent compact operator. So we've realized the second step in our program. For the generation of the full growth fragmentation semigroup, we use certain result, which is L1 version of the Miyadera perturbation. So essentially what we have to prove is that the spectral radius of the composition of B and the resolvent of T is smaller than one at the end. And this happens if our fragmentation rate satisfies certain properties. Depending on the space, we require either 17 or 18. I will not go into details because of time constraints. I will not go into details to explain what exactly these properties mean, but let me mention three things here. First of all, these properties are satisfied for a very large class of so-called homogeneous fragmentation rates. So if you consider fragmentation rate of this form, it appears in most of the papers devoted to the long-term behavior of the fragmentation equations. So if you consider cases like that, then we have then conditions 17 and 18 are satisfied. Moreover, these are very robust properties. It turns out that if they are satisfied for some alpha, that they are satisfied either for all alphas bigger than one, or there is a threshold, which in the case considered in remark one is actually also equal to one, for which it is satisfied. So it is sufficient to check that this property is satisfied for some value alpha, and then we can use actually any other x alpha to prove what we want. Unfortunately, assumption 16, so the assumption on thinness of the level sets of A, so assumption 16, this one, and assumption 18, so the assumption which ensures generation of the semigroup in X0 alpha are mutually exclusive. So in the future, we'll not consider case 11 in X0 alpha. Once we have this, we immediately obtain that the full generator is resolvent positive. And now what we need to get our asynchronous growth property is, of course, irreducibility. And this can be obtained by some assumptions. The assumptions look here to be quite technical, because we are really doing mathematical assumptions. But for example, assumption two is automatically satisfied if we consider a physically natural situation in which you have at least two daughter particles in fragmentations. There is no other possibility. So in most cases, as long as the fragmentation rate is always positive, then our semigroup is irreducible. There are some other cases, but I don't want to again go into details. So we cannot, we have a generation of the semigroup, and we have the fact that the resolvent of the generator is positive, sorry, is compact. But in general, it doesn't mean that the semigroup itself is compact. It happens if, for example, as I said earlier, the generator is, the semigroup is analytic, but we cannot hope for analyticity here because we have first order differential operator. But there is another way of actually showing the so-called spectral gap. So under sort of like relevant assumptions, we can prove that the essential spectrum of the semigroup, so the, roughly speaking, the spectrum minus the essential spectrum is the spectrum minus, roughly speaking, eigenvalues. So this is the essential radius, so the sort of like disk enclosing the essential spectrum. And this essential radius is strictly smaller than the spectral radius of the semigroup. And therefore, our semigroup will have the asynchronous exponential growth property. And this is actually quite, the proof of this result is based on a sequence of quite interesting steps. First of all, we in some sort of like artificial way split the operator B in such a way that we still have this operator here, B hat, is still positive. Sorry, this is actually wrong. So here should be B. And B is a nice, B bar is a nice bounded integral operator with compactly supported kernel. So the idea is to construct, to make this construction in such a way that this is a weakly compact operator. So here we have an operator which contains all bad things and something which is positive and weakly compact. And the construction is done in such a way that B hat will be smaller or equal, but not equal to the operator, original operator B. Thanks to this, actually, the generation property and all the properties of this operator are the same as of this one. Okay. Now we use the, let us say, UML formula in this form. So we relate V, the original semigroup, to the semigroup generated by T plus B hat. And here we have a weakly compact operator. And there is a result in L1, again, going back to Schlüchtermann, saying that such an integral is weakly compact. It's something which is called convex compactness property. Because of this, using old result of Kato, we can prove that essential spectral radii of V and V hat are the same. On the other hand, because we carefully constructed this split so that the operators are not equal, the resolvents also of these two operators are not equal. And we have this inequality here. And because the resolvent of T plus B is irreducible and compact, there is a result by Ivo Marek about monotonicity of spectral radii with respect to different various parameters of the resolvents, which tells us that in case like that, spectral radii of these two operators are strictly and in strict inequality. This implies in particular that the spectral bounds of these operators are also in this relation. And therefore, in particular, we don't have this spectral bound is bigger than minus infinity. And because in L1 spaces, the type of a positive semigroup coincides with the spectral bound, we obtain at the end that just by this chain of inequalities and equalities, we obtain that the essential spectral radius of V is strictly smaller than the spectral radius of V. So we have spectral gap. And therefore, because we have compactness, we have irreducibility, we have asynchronous exponential growth property by the results going back probably to Nagel and his group. Okay, so this is roughly speaking how the proof works. And just to summarize, remind you, assumption 10 was the assumption with the, roughly speaking, constant growth rate at zero. Assumption 11 was, so you can think about constant growth rate. Assumption 11, you can think like growth rate equal to X. So in general, we don't have generation in the homogeneous moment space for assumption. Then we have generation under certain condition here. And then we can prove AG, asynchronous exponential growth property here. Also on the diagonal, we have all the good things that happen. If we have assumption 11 in X zero alpha, we have generation, but whether there is AEG is an open problem. It is related, it's a technical problem related to the fact that the the compactness of the resolvent and the generation of the semigroup were obtained on the basis of two mutually exclusive assumptions. So this is all. Thank you very much for listening. Thanks.
Thank you much for your talk. Are there any questions?